Couples therapists, without breaking confidentiality, what are some relationships that instantly set off red flags, and do you try and get them to work out? When one person is entirely dependent on the other, especially at a relatively young age, I mean financially and emotionally, these are typically young women, sometimes young men as well, who do not work, do not have children, stay home all day, and have no friends or hobbies outside of hanging out with their spouse. Very unhealthy, and a huge red flag. Always ends in a painful and messy breakup. Generally, we try to get them to find a friend, join a community, get a job or volunteer something to provide them with self-worth and personal fulfillment outside of their spouse. One partner says they're seeking your services to help them determine if they want to stay together. The other partner says they're seeking your services to make it so they stay together. Then it's about highlighting the points and allowing the person who is on the fence decide what they want, since the other person knows. Edit: I'm sorry to be reading about how many people experienced being the person who wanted to stay together when their partner was unsure. I hope that, whatever happened, you have found or are finding happiness again. Child and family therapist here. Not exactly couples therapy, but there are key family dynamics that set off red flags for interpersonal relationships within a family, whether it is between parents, parents, and kids, or simply kids. The most important piece comes from invalidation. This comes in many forms, from gaslighting to just simple denial of another's opinion. Most of the time, one or both parties are simply trying to be heard on an emotional level with an event or topic that was brought up, but the other party takes this as a personal attack on their ideals. We've all heard of or know people who will literally disagree with anything you say simply because you said it. That's the invalidation I'm referring to. Cliché moral of the story: attack the problem, not each other. People rarely have the exact same stance in a conflict, but usually in healthy relationships have very similar core values. While two parents may disagree on how to parent a child, authoritarian vs authoritative for example, the core value of caring about their children and wanting them to succeed is often the same. By determining they are within the same realm of issue, two parents with different ideals can see themselves as allies in a conflict rather than enemies. Two things that people believe are red flags of poor relationships are the amount of conflicts the couple has and yelling. Neither is inherently a characteristic of good or bad relationships, but may be perceived as more common in bad relationships. The reality of this situation is that healthy relationships actually have a comparable amount of conflicts, but more intensely focus on addressing the core issue rather than the beliefs and self-worth of the other. As for yelling, in this case it's an emotional response to not feeling heard. While not the best response to distress, it also isn't an indicator of poor communication skills. What is an indicator of poor communication is yelling over the other person in an attempt to invalidate their point. Semi-related example. I had two people who were seemingly incredibly upset at each other. Parent A felt that parent B was out of the house too frequently and did not want to be a part of their children's life. Parent B felt that parent A didn't understand how busy their work schedule was. The fight revolved around parent B seemingly not caring about the kids, until parent B explained they felt parent A was better at parenting and felt like they were only escalating the children when they started to parent. Parent A's understanding of the argument quickly changed from "you don't love our children" to "you're scared to let our children down." As you can guess, the tone of the conversation changed dramatically and there was no longer a sense that parent A and B were on opposing sides. The issue instead became helping build confidence in parent B's parenting abilities, which parent A was much more validating and supportive of. Not all cases are this clean cut by any means, but I figured I'd demonstrate the basic idea of finding core values and attacking an issue together. I'm not a therapist, but my therapist straight-faced told me that there are worse options than divorce. Got divorced and it was the best thing that happened to me. I saw a couple that was doing retaliatory cheating and telling each other about it. When they got through their anger, they decided to call a truce and made peace. With their level of emotional maturity, I doubt it lasted. I don't know if I helped them or prolonged their suffering. It was their decision to come to counseling, so I think it was the help they wanted. Other clients realize what they really want is divorce counseling. What's the best way to behave civilly and minimize damage to the kids while we go our separate ways? People who approach therapy with the idea that they must convince the therapist that they're right and their partner is wrong. Almost like they're complaining to a parent or boss to have them sort out the problems. Contempt. When I experience true contempt from one in the relationship, I know it is usually over. Look towards a peaceful ending at that point if possible. Relationship therapist here. One of the biggest red flags I see when working with a new couple is when they've totally forgotten the good. Part of relationship therapy is reconnecting a couple with what they like about each other, what initially attracted them to each other, and what the positives are between them. When people come in, and they've been so unhappy for so long, that they actually can't remember what it was like to be in love, or to even like each other, they're just about hopeless. You don't have to be happy for therapy to work, but if you can't even reminisce about the good times, then the good times are probably over. Edit: this is clearly resonating with some folks, so I'd like to recommend a book. If you find yourself in this situation, check out Hold Me Tight by Dr. Sue Johnson. She gives some solid explanations of how people get into this cycle, as well as some suggestions on how to try and navigate it. 1. Couples in a tete-for-tat arrangement. For example, I cheated so you can have one night to cheat with whomever. Or I violated your trust and did drugs, you can go out and do whatever for one night. It erodes trust and compounds the hurt. 2. An affair that won't end. I've never seen a relationship bounce back where a partner is still in contact with their GFBF. I don't mean an ex-GFBF. I mean the person X is having the affair with, or is lying about it. 3. Control to an excessive amount. I most commonly see partners having to send pictures holding up a certain number of fingers, or proving that it's a live picture. This is abuse. 4. Overbearing parents and in-laws. I understand there's a ton of cultural nuance here, and I work with couples who have arranged marriages, as well as the South Asian community. However, when a spouse is more allied with their parents and calls them on speakerphone for fights, or often speaks ill of their partner to their parents, I usually see these couples stay very unhappily married for years. It's sad. If it's not abuse and a partner is willing to end an affair and genuinely work on it, I'll help support. I think couples therapy is sometimes helping couples have the courage to voice what they really want, and that may be separation. Edit: added another, and thanks for the awards, folks. Edit 2: I can't ethically dive into some of your comments or give specific resources, but get in touch with your local crisis line or community service agency and they can direct you. Wishing all of you the best with your relationships and in-laws and parents. Edit 3: I answered some of the common questions in the comments. I intentionally have to be really vague, and I can't comment on specific cases, it's unethical. I won't be able to respond to any more comments, because this blew up far more than I ever expected, but thanks for reading. I hope this helps open the door to therapy for you, or your loved ones in tough situations. If it's any help, I'm a therapist who goes to their own therapist. Also, some of these situations are nuanced, some are not. I'm not saying sharing your location with your partner is abusive, or that sending a picture to your spouse is. Therapists get a ton of data and history and information that helps us better understand what's going on. Sometimes, there's a dynamic between two people and they can set off a cycle. Read Sue Johnson's books for this, Love Sense and Hold Me Tight. Other times, I think it's unethical to assume a partner was hit because they deserved it or set their partner off. That's not okay. Please reach out to your local agencies and crisis line if you or a loved one needs help.